Lessons from the life of Brother Louis Camilleri, a Lasallian spirit. The mental prayers written by Brother Louis, for the sake of those who don't know anything about Brother Louis Camilleri was born 1923 and he died in 2011, and was proclaimed servant of God. These mental prayers, that's what he calls them, mental prayers, reveal a contemporary mind style that includes an awareness to reality in the service of education. Now, the book talks about the fruits of the mind, because my interest, although it's very often called that it's a biography, it is a biography. There is a lot of things about his life, but it is also about the way Brother Louis used to think. And we often try to get a portrait of his way of thinking through the writing. And Brother Louis wrote some prayers, and from those prayers one can actually elicit a sort of picture of his mind, and that is what I will be talking about in today's talk. Now, within this context, the concept of education is interpreted as a worthwhile mission, and the excuse me, and the key term is worthwhile. I will elaborate on this later on. Of course, worthwhile in the sense of in the Lasallian sense, as interpreted also by Brother Louis. So it is a worthwhile mission with normative implications, because it is mainly based on the universal principle of learner-centeredness. This is nothing new, but it has to be said, because one of the basic principles in the education vision, it concentrates on on the individual rather than on the subject. I don't know whether you can understand this, but I found this in my career. As soon as I left the brother school, I started my teaching career with the brothers, and then I moved into the state schools. And whereas in the brother schools, the emphasis was on the individual, when I went to the state schools, the emphasis was on the subject rather than on the students. Okay, so that's why I'm making this point. I think it is very relevant. The writings of Brother Louis, endowed with a beautiful mind, that's how I see Brother Louis. Brother Louis's contribution in his writing, are a means of communication with his target audience, who may be defined as all those who are interested in providing a sound and vigorous education to our young people. If at any time you want to ask something, just feel free to ask, okay? It doesn't matter, we don't have to go through the talk, and then we ask questions at the end. In this talk, I will try to show, as I said, his mental state within the Lasallian framework, mainly in the educational sphere. A life like that of this Christian brother, that is, a life embedded in a Lasallian culture, has to be seen against the backcloth of its contemporary scene. I'm saying this because sometimes people tend to say, is this Lasallian idea, is this Lasallian concept relevant today? I will try to show that, yes, it is relevant today, and I will tell you how in a minute. The thoughts coming from a finite mind have to be perceived as enacting their Christian part in the drama of the moral atmosphere of the times. Going back to the book, The Fruits of the Mind, in the writings of Brother Louis Camilleri, servant of God, is an attempt to show how through mental prayer, the emphasis is on this phrase, mental prayer. I will elaborate this in due course. Brother Louis came to love humanity for the service of God. The catchphrase, or the catch sentence in this case, is that he learned to love through prayer. Yes, it says a Lasallian spirit, so let me start. That was just an introduction. Let me start by explaining what is meant usually by Lasallian spirit. The term Lasallian describes a person who seeks to carry out the mission set out by Saint John Baptist de La Salle. His dates are 1651-1719. This mission embraces essential principles, which I am going to list because they reflect also on Brother Louis. And these essential principles relate mainly to a concern for the poor. There is an important term there, poor. I will elaborate this in due course. Respect for all persons, social justice, worthwhile education, inclusive community, and faith in God's presence. So the concept of Lasallian spirit comprises these core principles which are still needed in today's world, especially when our environment is seeing refugees and irregular migrants. In this case, these two fall under the term poor. Brother Louis Camilleri epitomizes this Lasallian spirit. Throughout his life, after feeling the Christian call, he was committed to living according to the gospel, promoting Christian values, and working to provide a quality education compatible with those values to the poor and the young. Again, I use the word poor. So, the poor, in this sense, in this Lasallian sense, is taken in a wide sense to include all those destitute financially, socially or culturally, emotionally and psychologically. And that is saying quite a lot. He endeavored to develop new aspects to meet the needs of contemporary education, and so he focused on the Lasallian vocation to commitment and togetherness, as evident especially in his establishing the Sinium Fidei Malta group. Now, the Sinium Fidei, which means the sign of the faith, is a Lasallian community of faith for adult lay people committed to a Christian life, striving especially to follow the gospel journey of Saint John Baptist de La Salle. I can't elaborate more than that, just to tell you what the Sinium Fidei is, but there are people over here who are expert on the subject, because they are the ones who really make Sinium Fidei alive. Going back to the prayers, the writing of his prayers was part of his personal vocation to make Christ present in today's world. His writings show him in solidarity with the poor, and they point out that he firmly believed in the living presence of God. His Lasallian spirit engaged him to welcome diversity, to respect the dignity of others, and to look to other people as being valuable in the eyes of God. So for him, the education of the individual was always worthwhile. And this concept of education being worthwhile was extremely important in the vision of Brother Louis. The education of the individual was always worthwhile for its own sake and not just for social convenience. This is important, but social convenience, of course, comes in as well later on. But first, education is worthwhile for its own sake. This was part of the logic of his faith. And in his logic, he examined critically the world in the light of his faith and within the Lasallian mission, which is an apostolic service authorized by the Catholic Church according to the norms established by Saint John Baptist de La Salle. to provide a human and Christian education to the young. Notice the term human, a human and Christian. Okay, there is really no barriers. Why? Because being Christian is being human. This is the way we have to think when we talk about these things. Okay, and the education of the young and the poor and the marginalized in schools identified as places of salvation. This education is conducted by professionals acting in association with others. These are standards and principles that are worthwhile and estimable in the contemporary Maltese scene, which may be swayed by an anti-foreigner sentiment. Since the islands are being inhabited by foreigners, some of whom are irregular migrants. Most non-Maltese residents, coming mostly from Europe and Africa, have into the Maltese nation over the decades. But there are still foreign communities consisting mainly of asylum seekers and irregular migrants who are facing problems. In the first quarter of the 21st century, in our islands, there are different attitudes towards non-Maltese residents. Some are positive, others are negative. This means that some non-Maltese residents, like the irregular maritime arrivals and their dependents, might find themselves marginalized. And this is not enough because there is not enough ideas on the subject. But this is already showing the relevance of the concept of helping the poor through education. Somewhere, I don't remember where in the writings of Brother Louis, he says that it is education that makes the man the person, okay? Now, we've been talking about education, so let's see the concept of education within all this system. Lasallian schools are characterized by a tradition of relationship-centered education, a tradition that spreads over a stretch of over 300 years. In his Lasallian perception, Brother Louis saw the teaching profession as a vocation, a true ministry that could create a practical community spirit. In him, St. Lasalle's thinking lost none of its relevance. Within the Lasallian community, a teacher is considered a minister of God that channeled truth. And the teaching ministry is charitable, enterprising, and accessible to all. In Brother Louis's vision, the educator has to focus on the manner of education with implications of learner-centeredness. This learner-centered concept is mainly based on the moral desirability to respect the young and the deprived. De La Salle expresses the idea that the educator's role should be not only as a teacher, but also as a guide. And this idea of being a guide within this concept is important. Guiding the young into worthwhile activities. Notice that the word guiding is not does not include any force in it. All right, it's not forcing them. It is guiding them, and that is important. The function of the Christian educator is therefore to reflect on the manner and the matter of education. Brother Louis, in his fundamental concern for the normative aspect of education, was educationally very perceptive, and institutionally he was interested in fostering students' curiosity so that they would be prepared better for employment. And there you are, the relevance of training, of guiding youngsters towards being productive in society. Being productive, we don't have to say an adverb like being productive positively or something like that. Once you're productive, obviously you're going to be productive in a worthwhile cause. And this within the concept of worthwhileness. In his educational vision, Brother Louis interrelated three major philosophical areas. There are ideas, experience, and development. Through these three categories, he recognized and encouraged differences in individuals. It is essential to realize that in his educational vision, he had traditional principles, but at the same time, he had liberal aspects as well. And that his teaching methods included an education that balanced the head, the heart, and the hands. He respected manual work. Most of us remember him putting up his sleeve and digging, literally. So he respected manual work and sought to educate the feelings, the intellect. But why? The hands, the heart and the mind, why? To train the will. That was the aim of doing these things. For Brother Louis, ideas that represented reality were important, and education had to contribute to help students acquire the mental training required to comprehend such ideas. And remember, he often directed people to train their will. That is important. Now, if we look at the language, the term educate is derived from the Latin educare, to bring up, to rear, educate, which is related to educere, to draw out, to lead out. The first one has the idea of nurture, and the second one, the idea of realization of a potential. And both these concepts merge in the aim of education that relates to equipping students as people to develop and to improve themselves. Education makes people what they are. It is only through education that they become and remain human. This is an essential principle in all this. And those of us who read most of his spiritual writing will realize that this is exactly what he was trying to do. These concepts have educational implications that are in harmony with Brother Louis's mental frame that embraces a liberal vision. They imply that education has to be valued for its usefulness and for its own sake. And they intimate that a balanced curriculum can contribute positively to the development of the whole person intellectually and morally. Furthermore, all subjects, the arts, humanities, sciences, vocational subjects, etc., have to be equally valued to give relevance to individual tastes. And consequently, Brother Louis used to encourage learners to develop ways of thinking. In fact, he often encouraged debate and discussion, especially among sixth formers. The notion that experience in education is as significant as theory was another category of thought in Brother Louis, especially when it involved discovery. That is why, for instance, he insisted on the use of the language lab in school. Learning entails either doing something or being done to. Doing something, that is, the learner is engaged in doing something. Students learn naturally from experiences and from coming into contact with key incidents. This involves discovery. Being done to, somebody is employed to do something to the learner. That means you have lessons taught to you. Students act as passive recipients of experience. In his concept of the education of the whole person, Brother Louis attached importance also to the student's emotions. Now, I'm saying all this just to show you that after all, Brother Louis was a common teacher. But you don't stop there, because Brother Louis had that title, Brother, which means the teacher combined with this Lasallian spirit, which I'm trying to explain over here, okay? And that is really the difference between a common teacher and you stop there. But over here you have a common teacher plus the Lasallian aspect. So, as I said, he attached importance to students' emotions, which implied care of an individual's feelings as well. So there was the concentration on the individual. He did concern himself with how individual students felt and thought. His approach was to encourage self-expression and self-actualization. Self-expression, that is the assertion of one's own personality. You express yourself, and when you express yourself, you pour out your personality. This happens even those of you who are familiar with literature. Whenever you read a poem or a novel, it's actually you're reading the mental state inside the personality of the author. Okay, this is what we mean by self-expression, that pours one's personality. And that's what Brother Louis, his approach, tried to achieve. And self-actualization, that is, the fulfillment of one's full potential through autonomy and creativity. There are many people who can talk about this, especially ex-sixth formers, who some of them I did put in their testimony in the book. In his Lasallian vision, there is implied a learner-centered type of education, even in the traditional methods of teaching. This approach, which aims at the development of the whole person, looks at experiences as relevant factors of education. But students need to be guided, and guided by capable teachers. Encouraging individual expression leads to the recognition of the singular characteristics of every student. Since all learners are different and are endowed with a unique individuality, and this individuality has to be valued and accepted for what it is by teachers. On their part, teachers in an appropriate environment have to exert control, and very often they have to facilitate learning experiences as they consider the dignity of each individual student. Development, essential in education, is a psychological category that is shaped by cognition and by biological growth. We're talking about development. It involves potentialities, the aim towards a final destination. Brother Louis believed that education must provide favorable conditions for development of students. Learners attain their full potential in an enriched school environment. The teacher must help the students to reach their potential. In his educational view, the spiritual and the secular were not really poles apart, and he firmly believed that the teachers were the best qualified to teach morality. And Lasallian secular teachers must balance the institute's culture with the general culture of the islands. That is, they must reconcile the demands of the Maltese culture and the Lasallian code of conduct. As the head of a school, part of his life was spent as a head of school, Brother Louis trusted the teachers to be interpreters of morality and consequently to consider the needs of the students and lead them to the type of life that fitted them best in the context of the social demands. He saw the teacher as the agent who dealt with morality at the practical level to get the students to understand the difference between what was socially and spiritually acceptable and what was socially and spiritually unacceptable. This implied teaching skills that helped individual learners to take their place in society as productive citizens, which includes being suitable workers. But he taught. He had a special way to show how to teach teachers. I remember at one time I was at Stella Maris and there was a boy who was shouting and he was really angry at something. I don't remember why, but he shouted. And Brother Louis just, he was the head, Brother Louis just stood there next to him very calmly and very quiet. I was actually, you know how you feel when you have this little person here shouting and denigrating even the brother. Now, I felt like I want to blow him out of the window. But Brother Louis remained very calm. And then the boy stopped, kept quiet, looked at the brother, and went to class. And I said, "Brother, why didn't you stop him?" "Ah," he said, "if I shout, he'll shout louder than me. But if I keep quiet, he will eventually lower down his voice." You see, he taught by this example. And this is what I mean when he tried to give hints, guides, even to teachers. This implied teaching skills that helped individual learners. Now, that was just one way. There are so many things to say about Brother Louis, but we can't explain everything. Over here, I'm just talking in general terms, right? So his aim was to teach skills that helped individual learners to take their place in society as productive citizens. And this is important, the idea of being a productive citizen, which includes being suitable workers, really. The learners must come to accept the moral demands of their contemporary society. Now, this is difficult because we have a society at the moment that is so rough, so rugged, so indifferent. And how can you try all this within such a society? But the learners, in Brother Louis's vision, the learners must be able to make moral choices in order to fit in as, again, I'm going to repeat it, productive citizens. Productive citizens does not mean that you earn a good salary or you buy a villa, not in this case, but being functional in your relationships with other people, especially. You're successful in society. It's all around. So moral choices entails a cognitive outlook. And this is what I mean when earlier on I said that he looked also at the mind of the people. He wanted to train the intellect. To underline these ideas in his spiritual writings, Brother Louis presented his modern conceptions of virtues like generosity and forgiveness. Generosity and forgiveness. Today's word, they're hard, but he showed how they can be still virtues in today's world. I have to elaborate a little bit on the concept of mental prayers, since I mentioned generosity and forgiveness, okay? And I don't know. I feel I've been talking a lot. Are you tired? If you're tired, we can have a break. I don't know what type of break, but if you feel like you want to do some press-ups, you can do press-ups if you want. Anyhow. Mental prayers. Brother Louis sustained his generous soul. He was always giving by living an interior life and engaging himself in mental prayer, some of which was then written down for the sake of other souls faced with interior desolation. By now it must seem obvious that praying was part of Brother Louis's pleasure principle, but his prayers depended upon the constitutive acts of his consciousness. So they require interpretation. One thing you must not do when you read his spiritual writings is you just can't read them and keep on moving. You have to linger a little bit, even upon single words, single terms. In another talk which we had at St. John's Cathedral, I showed how a single term in a prayer could really explode with meaning in Brother Louis's spiritual writing. Okay? I'm not going to repeat that over here because it might be too much. Reading these prayers, therefore, must be a creative process. This is what this type of writing, which is called in Lasallian terms mental praying, all right, is really a creative process. Readers must concretize the textual content and go beyond it. That is, they must add to what Brother Louis has provided. Concretization calls particulars to mind. Through reading, the prayers become subject to valuation and interpretation, which give shape to the awareness of the reader as perceiver. This is the process of concretization. Going beyond what is textually presented is a move towards completing the implied content, as some undefined areas are determined by the reader's thinking. As a brother within the Lasallian atmosphere, Brother Louis was first and foremost guided by faith and by the gospel. He was a man of faith living in the presence of God. God is felt to be present in his written prayers. God is constantly felt to be an integral part of the community, necessary for spiritual completeness. Brother Louis saw God in the events of his life, work, joys, and sorrows. And he set himself free of selfishness and responsibility because in his frame of mind, God made him a whole. His prayers were primarily private, never meant to be published. But eventually they were offered to the Lasallian community and some of them were included even in the Sinium Fidei booklets. They are meant to be part of a process of initiation and formation because in them Brother Louis tries to create in his readers an attitude of love for the living God. He believed that people could become spiritually mature as they came to know themselves and God better. These are prayers that teach readers to think, feel, and look at contemporary life from a Christian point of view. And furthermore, they are prayers that exclude no one. We can describe Brother Louis's mental prayers as a storehouse of the spiritual features of his mindset. In Brother Louis's written prayers, God is a center. For Brother Louis, a prayer was not to be thought as self-evident or as an inherited traditional habit. It's not the prayer that we learn at school, okay? But they are original prayers. And he is very creative in those prayers. It was not a matter handed down from previous generations, a prayer. The forms of prayer that he expressed complement the practical content of his Christian messages that issued from a free mental disposition. I'm saying this because we have to tie his idea of the mental prayer with his concept of education, All right? It is a complementary to the concept of education. Prayer for him was part of a dignified claim to truth that set itself up as a bridge between God and humanity, a bridge that was expressed in language as the main vehicle of thought. Moreover, in his prayers, he brought concepts like poverty, obedience, and charity down to practical issues, because he was convinced that in mental prayer there was no room for illusion. At one point, I made the argument that these mental prayers were really literature. But then I realized that people can interpret the term literature as being something that is related to fantasy or imagination. But the mental prayers are not. They are well placed in practical everyday behavior. In fact, his prayers support the Lasallian spirit. So his spiritual writings may be taken as acceptable guides to all of us, most particularly those in the educational sector, because the thoughts are generally viewed as an appropriate and desirable code within the contemporary context. An example of such a guide can be this principle of his. This is something, I must admit, this is a principle that I personally like a lot. I'm going to say it in Maltese. Ħadd m'għandu aktar bżonn ta' mħabba jekk mhux dak li ma jisħoqlux l-mħabba. Okay? If we were to translate it, it would be something like that. Like this, nobody needs love more than the person who doesn't deserve love. Okay? And that is exactly, I think, that is the essential, or rather the core aspect of his mindset. All right? In these spiritual writings, there was an integration between the praying subject and the community, or those who are in distress. The expectation of the communicant constituted an attitude with messianic consciousness, sending a message of reconciliation in a world that was fast becoming indifferent to religion. In his spiritual vision and expression, there was a fundamental presupposition of Lasallian understanding imbued with a perspective that had a profound insight into the presence of God in a modern, listen to this word, indifferent word. A practical perspective of human life with the Spirit of God in a materialistic world. And this is mainly his relevance. His practical perspective represented a Lasallian form of religious expression, and his writings present a perception that is educated by prayer. You see, this is a very important concept in him, that prayer is what makes you human. And the our perception through prayer improves. But remember that the idea of prayer is not saying the Our Father or things like that, something that is inherited. It's the spontaneous prayer, especially that you create when in need or whatever. In the light of all this, the naive assumption that prayer is automatic is fundamentally changed, so that prayer is not a mere passive form of language. Readers must make an active contribution of their own, and they also must make an effort to synthesize Brother Lewis's language with their own experiences. And I would actually say, once we read some of his prayers, we learn how to make prayers of our own, right? Not necessarily to publish them. We don't publish prayers. In this way, readers can perhaps be seized and uplifted by the profound harmony and virtue of the spiritual content of the prayers. In simple terms, the reading of these prayers needs thinking. Even if you don't create your own prayers, at least you have to think on the prayers that you read. Within the Lasallian spirit, prayer restores the beauty of the soul because it fosters calmness and humility. This is the aim behind these mental prayers. As a way of conclusion, I want to refer to a quotation that Brother Rodolfo Cosimo Meoli, general postulator, remarked that Brother Louis always sought concealment and humility. Brother Rodolfo says, saints, I'm quoting him, saints do not need a rich curriculum vitae. They are like the stars in the sky. We can never succeed to garner all the specific brilliance, and yet they shine marvelously in the sky. That's what Brother Rodolfo said. And this figurative language depicts quite aptly Brother Louis's situation. That is the talk I prepared for this evening. But I would like to refer to a prayer of Brother Louis. I want to show how he generates his language, all right? And what he does with the language. Lord, put your eyes instead of mine so that I can recognize those poor people of all types who are stretching their arms to me. Give me your ears to hear the moans and groans of those who are suffering, and give me that tongue of yours to conceive the consoling word. Give me those hands of yours to deliver them to those who need my help. Above all, give me your heart to see your face in my brothers and sisters, young and old, of all nations. What's so strange about this? First of all, you realize what is meant by these mental prayers, all right? It's a prayer that talks about the parts of the of the body. But Brother Louis conceptualized God in human terms as a way of condensation. And this helped him to think even better about his God and about the world of relationships. All right? This prayer involves extreme concentration of meaning through the composite structure of symbols. The prayer thoughts combine the symbolic characteristics of the different parts of the body to argue for a suitable interpretation. It is obvious that the author of this prayer has entered the symbolic domain so that the Lord is perceived, first of all, as a man conscious of his being, and secondly, that his organs are superior to those of the author. So over here, there is the human perception of God, all right, which is really a very common thing. The point is that with this unique mind style, there is a common element. I'm sure you and I have thought about these things as well. In wanting better eyes, the author knows, over here, we have to go into the symbolism, right? The symbolism as visualized by Brother Louis. In wanting better eyes, the author knows that the eyes provide the essence of man's intelligence because the process of seeing represents simultaneously the act of understanding. In Maltese, he says, naraf, for recognize. And do you know how to write naraf? Do you remember? It has an ayin in it. And the root is ayin, R-F, erf. Naraf, ikoll l-erf. Naraf, and Kunaf. And this is the way he uses his language in prayer. I'm referring to the Maltese version, of course, okay? Which is lost in translation, this part. Right, and the charitable, and this is what I mean when I said he enters into aspects of symbolism, all right? And the charitable desire to help all those who seek his support, لأدين إتاولو درايوم ليا, those who are stretching their arms to me. You know, visual perception, that is the bodily eye, and the author's mentality functions as a means of intellectual perception, a recipient of light in the sense of spiritual enlightenment. Spiritual because this is a prayer to our Lord, and for him, the Lord is the center. The center in psychological terms. The attitude presented in this first sentence of the prayer approaches the Jungian idea, the idea of Jung, that is, of the meaning of the eye as the maternal bosom of the child. The eye, and he plays with it. Why? The ein is the eye, but it is also a source. All right? So he plays on the two meanings in his prayer. Okay? You only realize this when you read the whole thing and you try to delve deep into the meaning of the prayer. Yes. And this is related to the author's care for the poor, because this care for the poor is a parental attitude of renovation. This is complemented by the image of the outstretched arms that signify invocation. Then the author moves to the ears, which stand for the receptive aspect of communication. The ears here are also related to intelligence because the faculty of hearing gives the author direction, and the ears become the organs of understanding human anguish and sorrow. For the author, therefore, the ears stand as the channel of spiritual enhancement, since he will try to comfort those who mourn. And this relates to Christ's second beatitude. Such solace requires the power of the tongue. There you are, another aspect of the human body. And hence the author needs to be creative to be able to provide psychological relief from pain. We must remember that the power of speech is one of the main characteristics that sets man apart from all other creatures. And the Maltese verb innissel, which literally means I procreate or generate, and it is figuratively linked with the creative power of language in the form of consoling word. This word innissel, when I came to translate it, I stopped on the word conceive, which connotes with contrive and create. You see what happened? Even the translator, in this case, okay, was forced to keep on thinking the way Brother Louis thought when he composed those prayers. All right? And I think that was one thing that I learned from Brother Louis. It's a skill, okay, which I referred to earlier on. I will stop there, and if you have any questions to ask, feel free to ask.